Hello and welcome. It's a pleasure to be here, if only virtually. So the title of my talk is The ImpFS File System. My name is Tom Ridge from the University of Leicester, and my web address is www.tom-ridge.com. Okay, so this is the introduction. So what is ImpFS? So roughly speaking, it's a file system and a collection of reusable file system-centric components that can be assembled in various ways to produce a file system. So here we've got some example components. So a persistent log, an on-disk B tree, path resolution could be a component, a POSIX API implementation could be a component, and so on. So basically lots of different components that you can plug together to make a file system to match your particular use case. So there are the GitHub links. The project is structured as many packages. There are lots of URLs for them. You can also find links to these from my webpage. And here is a picture showing the main packages and the connections between them. I would say that the main packages here are the B-tree package, the persistent list, persistent log, persistent cache, leading up to the key value store library. We've got path resolution. Over here, we've got some networking stuff, some front-end stuff, which we'll come on to later. And then finally, we've got the actual ImpFS implementation. To discuss the design of ImpFS, I want to talk about the layer structure. So the layer structure for ImpFS, the file system, looks something like this. We've got the front-end layers here. For instance, here you've got how do you want to mount the file system. It could be via fuse, or it could be over the network. You've got a POSIX-like API layer that's providing all the usual functionality, like unlink, rename, truncate, those kinds of things. Path resolution, so everyone is familiar with the concept of path resolution, and that's been pulled out as a separate layer. For the POSIX-like API layer, path resolution are expressed in terms of objects. So the objects are files, directories, symlinks, free lists, and the GOM. So files, directories, and symlinks are all familiar objects. And then there are some objects that are used internally by the file system. And then down here, we've got marshalling and the block layer, which we won't discuss too much because time is relatively limited. So we'll discuss the front layer first, front end layer first, and then path resolution, and then the POSIX-like API layer. Then finally, the bulk of the talk will be discussing the heart of the file system, which is the implementation of these objects, files, directories, and so on. Okay, so the front end layer is package mini-fs. There's a GitHub link there, and it's basically going to include things like the fuse front end, the network client, network server, this kind of stuff. So here I got a picture of some Lego bricks, and the idea is that you can plug the bricks together because they have a standard interface. So here we can see a fuse interface to a pass-through file system. So a pass-through file system would just take API calls and pass them through to an underlying file system. So that's two components that MiniFS provides. So here's an alternative. You've got a fuse interface to an in-memory file system. So that would give you a simple tempfs type setup. Here's a slightly more complicated setup. You might have fuse plugging into a network file system client, which would then communicate over the network to an NFS server, which again would hook up to a pass-through file system to the server's local file system. So this would be a way of exposing the server file system to the client over fuse. So MiniFS contains these components and more, and you can plug them together in the ways that I've shown here. And this is what we use to implement the front-end layers of the file system. So now we discuss the front-end path resolution, which has been broken out as a separate layer. Of course, it's not independent of the file system. So this is what we need from the file system in order to implement path resolution. So in this type, file ID is a type of file identifiers. Dir ID is a type of directory identifiers. T is a phantom type variable for the monad. So what do we need from the file system? We need to know the root directory And we also need to know how to resolve a single step on the path, because that's a single path component. So given a directory and a name, a path component name possibly in that directory, we expect to get back the result of resolving that name. And this type variable T and the M indicates that this all occurs in the monad. So once we have that from the file system, we can implement path resolution, and this is what it looks like. We've got a function resolve, which takes the usual monadic operations, so these are bind and return. It takes from the file system the ability to resolve a single directory entry, so this is the type above. It takes a flag follow last symlink, which controls a lot of path resolution variability around symlinks, especially in the last component. And it takes the current working directory, so that's necessary to resolve relative paths such as dot and dot dot. Then we take a string, which is the path itself, and we get back a resolved path or possibly an error. Okay, here's the next slide. This is the POSIX layer. So this is what provides you the POSIX-like API functionality. So it's the things like the usual file system operations like rename, unlink, truncate, these sorts of things. And it's expressed in terms of objects, so things like files, directories, path resolution, of course, and maybe some other things. So let's have a look at the example code for unlink. So this is a very simple call. So we're trying to unlink an entry in a directory. So we resolve the path and give it an indication how we want the last component of the path to be treated. Path is the thing that we're trying to resolve. This is a monadic bind that propagates errors. So if there is an error during path resolution, that's what's returned. But if there isn't, we go on to examine the result of path resolution. So we would typically expect to get parent directory, a last name in the path, and the result, i.e. what was pointed to in the directory. So that result could be missing, for example. If you want to copy a file from one place to another, you would expect the destination to be missing. But that isn't a path resolution error. That's a normal feature of path resolution. But if it is missing, there is no way we can delete it. So that's obviously an error for unlink. Otherwise, if the name is present in the directory, we attempt to find the parent in the directory, the parent directory. Then we take the last component of the path, which must be less than 256 bytes. Nothing particularly special about this limit. It could be 1024 bytes, for example. And we simply delete that name from the directory. And that's the end of the unlink call. Okay, we finished with the front end. So now we come onto the heart of the file system, files, directories, and symlinks, and some internal data structures, such as the free list and something I've called the GOM. But just a short note before I begin. So objects are as independent as far as possible. We imagine that each object has its own block device because future storage devices will effectively support per object sync and barrier, and we want to play to that interface. So each object must maintain on-disk consistency. That is, in the event of a crash, some reasonable version of the object must survive. The object should also support a flush and a sync. So that's the general design as far as objects are concerned. So now let's talk about the implementation of directories. Okay, so directories are a map from path component, e.g. string, to an object identifier. So let's have a look at this. So if we have a file slash temp slash f1.txt, which corresponds to a directory slash temp and an entry name f1.txt, and this maps to whatever the actual implementation of f1.txt is. So the objects that can appear in a directory are files, directories, and symlinks. And that's all currently. So in order to implement this, we're going to need an on-disk map data structure. Unfortunately, we've done some previous work on these on-disk map data structures. So in OCaml 2017, there's some work on a B-tree library for OCaml. But the problem with this is that the performance is not as fast as the current fastest key value stores. So in order to improve the performance, we need to do something else. And what we decided to do eventually is to add a log onto the front of the B-tree. So write operations go directly to the log, and periodically the log is merged with the B tree without blocking. So once you have an on-disk persistent map data structure, it's very easy to implement a directory. It's just the use list, which is a list of all of the blocks used by that particular directory. And the other part of the pair is you've got an on-disk map representing the entries in the directory. So it's a map mapping the name to the underlying object ID. Okay, so moving on, we've got the implementation of files. So it's a similar idea. We're going to use maps again. So a file is just an array of bytes. So here we've got byte 0, byte 1, byte 2, etc. But nothing fancy at all. So we're going to implement this as a file size paired with an array of blocks. So a block is something like 4096 bytes. It's the natural unit of storage for the underlying block device. So we've got the first block, the second block, the third block, and so on. Obviously, we need to record the file size separately, since we're storing complete blocks, which would otherwise force the file to be sized as a multiple of the block size. So we have to record the file size separately. And then for block I in the file, we need to know the location on disk of that particular block. So that's why we need a persistent map from index I to the location of the block on disk. So this map will say something like block 0 is actually located at wherever it's located on disk, block 1, likewise. So there's no restriction on where these blocks can be located. For a hard disk drive, you might want them located adjacent to each other, but for other devices, this might be less important. So let's have a look at the OCaml type. So here is the OCaml type for the on-disk file data structure. As you can see, it's parameterized by the type of block identifiers. The type is called file origin block. The idea is that the origin block is the block from which an on-disk object can be reconstructed. So all on-disk objects, files, directories, symlinks, free lists, use lists, etc., they all have an origin block. And from the origin block, you can reconstruct the entire object. So what have we got here? We've got file size, we've got timestamps, we've got this block index map root. So this is the root of the B tree or the key value store that stores this mapping from block I to wherever block I is located on disk. We've also got this. So again, it's another origin block. It's the use list origin. It's the list of all the blocks in use by this file. So whenever we allocate a block to be used by a file, it effectively gets added to the use list. So here's the use list. A file's origin block contains a field referencing the associated use list origin block. So there's no permissions, you'll note. So permissions are quite simple to layer on top. And there's no end links reference counting because the free space management is currently in a state of flux. Hopefully it'll be done sometime soon. Okay, well, that was files and directories. You need a few more things to implement the file system. So let's start with the global object map, abbreviated GOM. Suppose you're given an object ID, like it's a directory with this ID or a file with this ID. So you need to be able to somehow figure out where that object is located on disk, or at least the origin block for that object. So we have the global object map, which is a single map for a given file system. Essentially, it maps object identifiers to blocks on disk that contain that object's origin block, and from whence you can reconstruct the object itself. Of course, this is an on-disk map. In addition to the global object map, you're also going to need something like a global free list. This is something like a list of all the free blocks. Well, not exactly that, because that would be too inefficient. But somehow you need a structure that can track the free blocks and give you alloc free functionality on blocks. I won't discuss it much because there simply isn't time. Now, I should talk briefly about the advantages of this design, the interesting aspects I think it has. There's a few components, the list and the map, which can be optimized extensively. The B-tree and the key value store have been optimized in the past. They've also been edited since, so they probably need another round of performance tuning. But the point is, I'm convinced that these can be made to run very quickly. So the design is highly modular, made up of reusable components. and we've made an effort to parameterize all the things. So the idea is that each component assumes the minimum possible in order to get its job done. But this means that you need to spend a lot of time spelling out what the requirements are, and then instantiating the particular abstract component, and then linking the components together. So each component has a clear semantics. Overall, the design is very simple. Hopefully, nothing about the implementation of directories or files is at all surprising or problematic. It's potentially verifiable using existing verification techniques, but I tried to make it so that one wouldn't need advanced logical techniques or anything like that. So a simple operational approach with a bit of separation would probably do the trick. And the performance is, so it's potentially very good. It's designed for future interfaces that we don't really have access to at the moment. And in particular, I'm thinking about highly parallel interfaces direct from user space to SSD or non-volatile memory. That's the case where this file system would really shine, I think. But some effort needs to be put into optimizing the code, of course. Okay, so we're running out of time, but we have just a chance to see the thing in action. So here we go. So this is a video I made of the current state. We'll see what happens. We're going to run the fuse version of ImpFS and mount it in the local directory. So make run from clean, which I'm typing here. So this tells it to start the file system from scratch, ignore any previous state, create a clean and empty file system. And lots of stuff gets printed out. It's rather chatty at the moment because of all the debugging stuff, but obviously that's likely to change. So one of the nice things that you'll see, you can see the file system is operating. And when we do an operation over here on the left-hand side of the screen, what you'll see is that sometimes when we press tab to autocomplete, you'll see that the file system responds sort of in real time. So there we tried to complete on fuse mount, and Bash has tried to complete that by calling into the file system to find out what the contents of fuse mount is. Okay, so here we've written some text to a file. We can list it, we can cat it, we can append something to that file. So here we're going to append something to the file and list it again, and then we can cat it again, and lo and behold, it's all worked. So it's not particularly amazing, except that I'm always somewhat surprised that it works, given how complicated the underlying machinery is with the B-trees and all those kinds of things. Okay, we're running rather low on time, so just a few comments on performance and project status. So I believe the performance should be very good. Of course, it's easy to say this, but the main reason is that the design matches closely the future queue-based APIs of block devices. And also on preliminary performance tuning I did on the B-tree and the key value store last year, that indicated that it would be possible to get very good performance. Unfortunately, it's still too early to report on this, for which I'm sorry and apologize. The project status, so it is still some weeks away from being in a reasonable state. You can try it out, but I would wait a few weeks if I were you. There are some things that are missing. In particular, the free space management is lacking currently, and the cross-object guarantees need more attention. Okay, so that's the end of the talk. Thank you very much for listening, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.